Good morning. My name is Michael Corbett. Welcome to Williamson Free Methodist Church on this first Sunday of 2018. This is January 7th. Fun fact, even though we might say that date as 1-7, the rest of the world would say that date is like 7-1. I feel like I heard that number recently. Maybe that was the Big Ten's record at Williams this year. Anybody know why that was there? Brandon? It's okay, Brandon. You don't have to cry. It's okay. You can save your tears for Saturday. You'll need them then, too. It's okay. So, on to things that actually matter, not MSU sports. If you were here last Sunday, we did a little members vote right after church was finished. And if you're interested in becoming a member, having a part in the say of who gets to stand up here and do announcements or what other leadership positions we have in our church, you are more than welcome to become a member. And we've made that really easy for you now, actually. You can do it online through Right Now Media. I don't have a link for you right now. I don't know it. But if you ask Brandon, I'm sure Brandon knows that link, or if you just call into the office, again, much easier. You don't have to sit with Doug for like 5 hours anymore. You just do that. So you're welcome to become a member of the church. We would love to have you. Todd has left me high and dry this morning, so I have a coffee mug here to show you. If you are with us for the first time today, even if it's like your fifth time, that's okay. We would love for you to take this Williamson Free Methodist coffee mug home with you and grab one at the Welcome Center on your way out. And my last announcement for today, I need Peggy Weiss, Dave Kruger, and Tom Davis to come join me for just a second. Not a joke. I don't see Dave. So as a part of that little vote that was last week, we have some outgoing leadership team members. If you don't remember, I'm the chair of our leadership team. And Tom, Dave, and Peggy are leaving our leadership team this year after many, many years of service. I can stand up here and say too many nice things that you wouldn't want to hear for too long. Instead, I'm just going to give them a gift, and hopefully you will help me in thanking them for their service.
My hope is found. He is my Thank you. are a God who can do all things. And so, Lord, this morning, we want to wait and expect and see, Lord, that you're going to move. That there's mountains that people are facing that you're going to move, Lord. That there's obstacles that you're going to move, Lord. Lord, we trust you, and we turn our eyes towards you. And I pray that the worries and the fears and the doubts of this world, Lord, would fade away, and all that we can see, Lord, is you this morning. We love you, Lord, in your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.
As you find your seats, I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward. God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this time that we can gather, that we can worship your name. God, that we can dig into your word, that we can learn more about you. God, I pray that this time is fruitful. I pray that you speak through me this morning. And I pray that the words I say are exactly what people need to hear. God, I pray for this offering. I pray that you multiply it and that you use it to grow your kingdom. Amen. All right, so just a little introduction about myself, if we haven't met yet. My name is Brandon. I'm a lot like Doug. We have all the same interests. As it was pointed out, I guess we have the same hairline. But the one thing that's different about me is that my jokes are funnier. So, the first thing I was going to do this morning was to apologize on behalf of my Wolverines. But Michael kind of stole my thunder, and man, I don't even know what to say after that. That was a good one. But yeah, Big Ten, 7-0. And then Michigan goes out in that field and does whatever that happens. I was holding a baby during the entire second half, and it's a very good thing because I would have thrown something at the TV. But like any true fan and believer of Harbaugh, we'll get them next year. I've said it three times already, why not say it again? But just to recap where we started last week, Dave gave this introduction to this concept of raising the bar. He showed off this tremendous feat of athleticism and leapt very gracefully over that bar. Just introducing the topic that God wants us to raise the bar in our life. God wants us to hit the next level. He wants us to rely on him to accomplish that, and he wants us to honor his life, honor him by giving him our lives. This morning, we're going to get a little more specific into that topic, and we're going to talk about something that our lives and our culture are surrounded by, something that our lives are consumed by, and that topic is time. When we think about time, we think about how we talk about it and what our conversations are regarding time. The most frequent question that we ask is, what time is it? How many of you have already asked this question at least once today? I asked this question to myself four times last night because I thought I slept through my alarm and was missing first service. Luckily, it was the middle of the night. We're good, we're here. But we ask ourselves this question all the time. What time is it? As a parent, Melanie and I ask each other this question constantly. We ask, what time is it? What time is it that he had a nap last? What time is it that his next nap is going to be? That's the more important one. What's the last time that he ate? When is he going to need to eat again? What time is he going to need a diaper change? What time did we change his diaper last? What time is it that... What time was it that we asked what time it was last? We're just constantly asking these questions and wondering, what time is it? But it's not just a question for parents, it's a question for all of us, as you know. For me, I think the moment in time in my life when I asked this question the most was when I was working in my last job, which was in accounting. If you don't know what the life of an accountant looks like, let me give you this really exciting view. I would walk into my workplace, it was in Auburn Hills, Michigan. I would walk in, I would sit in my chair, I would roll it up to my desk, And I would sit there, and that would be at 7:30, and I would sit there until 5 o'clock. It's about as exciting as it sounds. And as I sat there for what seemed like eternity, I would ask myself this question: what time is it? And this is just an estimate, but I think it was around 300 times in a day that I asked myself, what time is it? Because I was just waiting for it to be 5 o'clock so I could punch out and go home. Luckily, I'm not there anymore, and you guys have blessed me with an opportunity to work here, and I ask myself this question a little bit less. But it's a question that we all ask ourselves. It's a question that just surrounds us in everything we do. It's an important question, and it's a constant question, but it's not the most important, not the most important question that we can ask ourselves about time. The most important question that we can ask ourselves is, what am I doing with my time? What am I doing with my time? The reason that this question is so important is that our days are numbered. And we're going to look at this a little bit closer. Our days on this earth are so short, especially in the big picture of eternity. So we're going to look at some verses here in a second that may be a little discouraging and a little depressing, but we're not going to focus on that. We're just going to use them to get the point across that our days are numbered. So stick with me, even though it might get a little sad. So I'm going to go ahead and contradict myself here, because I just said we're not going to get depressed, and now we're going to look at the book of Job. So this is what Job says, real upbeat verse. It says, my days are swifter than a runner. They fly away without a glimpse of joy. Basically what he's saying is our days fly by. The last time I was getting my hair cut at the hairdresser, which doesn't happen all that frequently because when I was in college, I bought a $30 set of hair clippers, and I cut my own hair. I cut it this morning. It looks pretty good, doesn't it? But the last time I was in there, the lady who was cutting my hair asked me how old I was. And I gave her the answer of an age that was my age 3 years ago. Why do I do that? It's because we lose track of time. Time goes by so fast, we don't realize that time just shoots on by. And I don't know if you parents are out there that may have this experience. I know my dad, whenever he was asked my age, he would always answer something that was not my current age. It's because days fly by. We don't realize it, and we're not aware of how fast they turn. Time is flying, that's what Job is saying here. Moses talks about this topic as well in a song that he writes. When we think of songs, we don't always think of Moses, but Moses is the author of a psalm, Psalm 90. And Psalm 90, verse 1, says this: a prayer of Moses, the man of God. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, where you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Now this next verse, one of the more fun verses to read in the Bible, you really have to channel your inner deep voice. You turn people back to dust, saying, return to dust, you mortals. Maybe I'm the one that thinks that was fun. A thousand years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. So picture this giant timeline that stretches from everlasting to everlasting. It's never ending on both ends. It stretches out forever. But just so we can kind of wrap our minds around this, let's just say that it goes from that side of the stage to the other side of the stage. It's this timeline that represents all time, everlasting to everlasting. And somewhere on this timeline is us. And on this timeline, the section that represents us on this huge scale is so small that we can't even see it. It's such a little tiny sliver that we can't even make it out on this huge timeline. And again, that's not to make us feel insignificant or depressed, but just to realize and get an awareness that our days are short, our days are numbered, and they're not going to last forever here on earth. In verse 4, it says, a thousand years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. A watch in the night, back in the day, there were shepherds who watched sheep, and at night they would take turns, and each turn was called a watch. And a watch would last anywhere from 4 to 8 hours. So a watch, 4 to 8 hours, to God is like a thousand years. A thousand years to God is like 4 to 8 hours. So our time is a blink of an eye. Moses goes on in the same psalm, and we're going to pick up in verse 10. It says, our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures, yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass and we fly away. If only we knew the power of your anger, your wrath is as great as the fear that is your due. And if you're saying, what did I just read? So am I. So we're going to go back and read verse 11 again. If we only knew the power of your anger, your wrath is as great as the fear that is your due. Basically, what Moses is saying is that we're human, and with our minds, our finite minds that can only comprehend a small amount, we can't even envision the fullness and the greatness and the amazingness of God. If we were, this is what he's getting at, if we were able to get that glimpse of God, we would be blown away, and we would give God everything that he is due. We would give him all of our lives, all of our time, all of our resources. We'd give it to God because we would realize how amazing he is. Here's the verse that we're really getting at. That was verse 12. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Moses' prayer here in these couple verses is saying, look, God, I don't know how much time we have. It might be 70 years. It might be 80 years. It might be way less than that. We don't know. There's no way to know how many days that we have. But what we do know is that it's short, and it's not going to last forever. And I know as I say this, it's a logical conclusion. It doesn't take a lot to realize this or to reach this point that I've led you to this morning. And I know a lot of you know this personally. You've experienced how short life is in a personal way, whether you've lost someone close to you at an early age, or you've been through some type of life change that's made you realize how short life is. For Melanie and I, it was when her dad had a stroke a couple years ago. It kind of woke us up and made us realize that life is short and it's not going to last forever and it may not be the same forever, so we need to make today count. We need to make our time count. It's part of the reason why whenever I'm on my phone, you always tell me, put your phone away, because our time matters. Moses' prayer here to teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom speaks to this point exactly. He says, if we only knew how short our time is, if we only knew how precious and how small it was, then we would live and we would act so differently. He's saying, God, please give us a wisdom to know how to use our time. So let's look at it this way. Whenever we believe that we have more of something than we really need, we end up wasting it. Whenever we believe that we have more of something than we really need, we end up wasting it. Picture it this way. If we think we have this excess of time, if we think we have, oh, we have tomorrow, we have next week, we have next month, we have next year, we have time, we have whatever we can do whatever we want now because we have this excess of time. If we think that way, what we'll end up doing is we'll end up wasting our time. Because when we get that mindset, we waste the precious gift of time that God has given us. We waste each a day that God has given us to make an impact. We must use time wisely. We must use time to leverage the gift of time that God has given us. We must use it to help leverage and raise the bar in our lives. So when we look at this question of what am I doing with my time, it leads us to look at the priorities that we have in our lives. So this is where we get to the fun part over here. Our priorities. So this jar, this jar represents time. Any allotment of time. Oh yeah, I can't take credit for this illustration. I stole it from Andy Scanley, who's a pastor of a large church in Atlanta. But I just loved it so much that I had to use it. So this jar represents time. They sell it at Hobby Lobby, $24.99, 40% off though, so it's good. But it represents time. It could represent a day, it could represent a year, a week, a month, whatever. It could represent your whole life. But that's what this jar is, and this jar is just another section of time. And these small pebbles represent the things in our life that take up our time, that we would admit maybe don't add that much value to our lives, but we still take time to use them because they're pleasurable, or they're fun, or exciting. For some of you, the majority of these rocks could be spending time on Facebook, You could be shopping online, watching Netflix. If you ask my wife, all of my small rocks represent fantasy football. Which, by the way, she's not really happy that I say this. I won one of my fantasy football leagues. Cool, man. Yeah. And in the mail this week, I got the prize that goes to the winner every year, which is a giant, WWE-style belt. So I was wearing it. I was putting it on Hudson. I was hanging it on the wall. Where it's going to end up is right above Hudson's crib, so he knows what to look up. But fantasy football doesn't add much value to my life other than the belt. It's just small rocks. It's small things that we throw into our life that at the end of the day don't make much of an impact. But they take our time and they fill up our jar and they reduce the amount of space that we have left. And now these big rocks, these represent big priority items in our life. You're going to have to use your imagination here because these aren't rocks, they're balls from Hudson's ball pit. Good thing he's sleeping right now or he'd be mad that I stole them from him. But they're big rocks that represent priorities in our life. So let's not drop them. Let's say that these balls represent time that we spend exercising, or times that we spend with our family, times that we spend with our friends, time that we spend studying and dealing with our finances, and time that we spend with God. And all of a sudden, we start trying to jam in these big priority items into our life, and they don't fit. There's no time left in the day. How many of you have had this feeling where you're trying to jam everything in, but there's no time, and it's spilling over and you're overflowing? I know I felt it. And this happens when we don't prioritize, when we don't put an emphasis on the big things in our life. What if we do it the other way? What if instead of putting in all the small rocks first, what if we put in the priorities first? What if we spend our first time, our first priority on God, and our families, and our friends, and our studies, and our finances? I have one too many balls. And our exercising, we put all those in first. And then with what we have left over, then we get to the stuff that's fun and exciting and pleasurable. And then we start to get our fantasy football belts. And then we start to shop online. And then we start watching Netflix with all the leftover time we have. When we put that after the priority items, when we dump that into our time after we've gotten to our priorities, prioritize God and our family and our friends and our time and our studies and whatever, when we dump the little things in second, suddenly everything fits. Pretty cool, right? So our priorities determine our capacity. Our priorities determine how much we can fit into our time. The purpose of this exercise was not to show how good I am at dumping rocks into a jar, although I am pretty good. But it was to show and hopefully get us to ask the question, what are the big rocks in my life? What are the things that I'm dumping in my time jar first? What are the things, whether good or bad, that I'm prioritizing? And this is a question that you can talk about on your way home, you can talk about with your spouse, your family, or if you're going to a care group tonight or later this week, you can talk about this question. What am I making a priority in my life? What am I making sure I have time for? The follow-up question to that is, what are the big rocks that you want to have in your life first? What are the priorities that you want to have in your life? What are the things that you say, I really need to put this first, I really want to put this first, so I need to make that happen. I need to raise the bar in my life to make sure that happens. And that's another question you can talk about. So what does the Bible say about what our priority should be? The Bible is pretty clear about what the top priority not only should be, but what it needs to be. In Matthew chapter 6, it's just 33 on the screen, but I'm going to start in verse 31. says, therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. So, what shall we eat, what shall we drink, what shall we wear? All of those things, in one way or another, are these small rocks. What the Bible is saying is, seek first the kingdom of God. Don't worry about those things. Seek first, use your priority. Put in your bucket first the kingdom of God, and put in first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. So, what does that mean? What does it mean to seek the kingdom of God? What does it mean to seek his righteousness? It's just a way of saying that we need to be seeking God out first in everything we do. It's seeking God to give us the heart of wisdom that Moses was asking for in Psalm 90. It's asking God, what do you want us to be filling our time with? So that leads me to a challenge that I have for you. This is a challenge part one of two. So the first challenge is this. To spend the first few minutes of your day, every single day, for the next week, or for the next month, or for the next year, or however long, spend the first few minutes of your day with God. Because when you do this, when you say yes to God, when you put God in first, it will change your way of thinking. It will reorient your world. When you say yes to God, it's much easier to say no to all the other distractions. It's easier to say no to watching Netflix or fantasy football or whatever. The first few minutes of your day and your time set the pace and the direction for the rest of your day and for the rest of your life. When you spend those first few moments and minutes with him, it can change your attitude. You become much less worried about how much you can jam-pack into your day. And you become much more concerned about your ability and your willingness to serve God and to honor him. When you put the God rock in first, again, it reorients how you think. So that's the first challenge, to put God first, to make time in the first few minutes of every day to spend with him. The second part of the challenge is this, that every day you pray the prayer that Moses wrote in Psalm 90. And that you would pray this, that God, teach me to number my days so that I may gain a heart of wisdom. Teach me what rocks I need to put in first, what steps I need to take, so that when I spend my time, it's honored and it's glorifying to you. So why is this a challenge? Why do we have to do this? It's because God's not going to bust into our lives and say, hey, I'm a priority, make me a priority, and I'm here, and I'm going to force you to do it. That's not the attitude that God has. It's not his strategy. His strategy is found in Revelation 3, verse 20. It says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. God's there at the door. He's waiting for you to open it up and to let him into your life. He's waiting for you to open up the door, to let him into your jar, and to make him a priority. He's not going to force his way in. It's a choice that you're going to have to make. Are you willing to raise the bar in your life, and are you willing to do that? So to recap this morning, it's your lucky day. We're going to get out a few minutes early. To recap, though, stay tuned. First, sorry, Big Ten fans. Second, our days are numbered. Not a scary realization, not something that should be depressing, but something that needs to wake us up to realize that we need to be wise with how we spend our time. Third, our priorities determine our capacity. Our priorities, what goes in our jar first, determines how much we can fit in our jar. And fourth, the Bible is clear that that number one priority, the first thing in the jar, needs to be God. So are you willing to raise the bar in your life to make that happen? As we close, I've got a short video that I think really powerfully recaps some of what we talked about this morning. So let's take a listen and then I'll close this in prayer.
We're in a race against time, with the ticking tocks of the clock are looming close behind. Life is short and time is swift. And by the time that we realize that time is a gift, we have missed out on time's preciousness. Trying so hard to be at the right place at the right time that we barely have time to breathe. Trying so hard to make it to the big time that we miss out on all the time in between. For time is money, and no amount of it can buy time back. For it's only a matter of time until your time runs flat. Our greatest resource is our time. We spend all of our time trying to collect resources. And then whenever we have accumulated, you know, we don't have enough time to actually enjoy them. How come whenever someone asks us for the time, we will answer them in haste? When someone asks for a moment of our time, we say we have no time to waste. We save time, we invest time, we take time off. But all the while, time keeps ticking away on the clock. Until the sands of time have passed the line and our time is up. Whenever we realize that this borrowed time has finally run out. So how are you spending your time? Are you letting it slip through your fingers as you're scrolling through Twitter? Is the only time that your family actually together whenever you are huddled around your TV for dinner? Because if so, you probably have some things that you need to reconsider. Because time is precious, and it can be gone in an instant. And if you don't look up from all of these distractions, then you just might miss it. For there isn't enough time for you to be straddling the fences, for you will be known for your actions and not your intentions. Because time's a waste, and don't be complacent. Procrastination is the thief of time. And the only thing that time doesn't do is time doesn't rewind. So Lord, I pray that the ticking clocks of the clock won't be seen as reminders of our doom, but of the promise of perfection coming soon. So what are you going to do? How are you going to use this gift of time that has been graciously given to you? Because Christ didn't die for you to not bear fruit. He had nails in his wrist, a sword in his side, so that you could deeply murmurs, so that you could relentlessly pursue a life worth living and time worth giving. So how are you spending your time?
So let's pray. God, what stuck out to me in that video was his line that said, we will be known for our actions and not our intentions. God, help us to live a life that is full of action, that's full of prioritizing you, that's full of putting your big rock of you in our jar first. God, I pray a blessing over everyone here this morning. I pray that as we move from this place that we'll take in some of the lessons we've learned this morning, and that we'll be able to focus on you and accept those challenges that I gave this morning. That we'll be able to seek you out first this week. In your name we pray. Amen. You are dismissed.